At one time in January, we spent a week in Andalusia, in the south of Spain. We have decided to stay in Fuengirola, a seaside town west of Malaga on the Costa del Sol. Our plane lands at night, and after driving around in our rental car for hours trying to find our accommodation, we finally check in on Friday around midnight. We stay in this simple apartment hotel in Fuengirola. Across the road we find a large shopping center with many fine shops. There also is a marvelous supermarket where we go to get our supplies on Saturday morning. The fruits and vegetables are nicely displayed. The fish is fresh and looks appetizing. It can be custom cleaned right in front of your nose. We cannot keep our eyes off the racks upon racks of ham. Apparently the black Iberian ham is the best and the most expensive. Once we have stocked up, we drive to the waterfront, lined with block after block of hotels and apartments, overlooking long stretches of fine sandy beaches. A delight for sun worshippers from all over Europe. It being January, it isn't really warm enough to lie on the beach, even though it is quite sunny. And we are not really interested to play volleyball. Thus, unfortunately, we have to be content with sipping some cool Spanish white wine. The next day, Sunday, we hop into our rental car and drive into the hills, passing several white villages and going through some beautiful and also very rugged countryside. In the Sierra de las Nieves, the mountains reach heights of 2 kilometers. Because of its karst topography, there are many caves and shafts, dropping down hundreds of meters. The park of the same name is a hiker's paradise, with many marked trails, both long and short. At one of the park entrances is this monument of father and son, looking out over this fabulous countryside. On Monday we drive to the mountain village of Ronda, first settled by the early Celts in the 6th century BC. The present village is of Roman origin. In Ronda, one of the oldest bullfighting rings in Spain, built in 1784, is mostly a museum. But once a year the Corrida Collesca, a unique and historical bullfight, takes place right here in the Plaza de Toros. Bullfighting used to be the sport of noblemen and gentry. However, although the Catholic Church was among the most prominent breeders of fighting bulls, the Pope in the 18th century issued a decree threatening excommunication to any nobleman doing the fighting. From then on, low-born professionals did the fighting and killing for them, and that was okay. Ronda sits on a plateau of a large rock outcropping. It is famous for its dramatic escarpment vistas and the deep El Tajo Gorge that carries the river through the town. Built by the same architect that constructed the bullring, the Puente Nuevo, New Bridge, which opened in 1793, is the tallest of 3 bridges spanning the river, towering 120 meters above the canyon floor. From the bridge, we have some marvelous views. Because of the cliffs, Ronda was one of the last Moorish cities to fall during the Reconquista of Spain by the Catholic monarchs. After Granada was conquered in 1492, the Spanish decreed that Muslims and Jews must either leave or convert to Christianity. Those who converted while secretly practicing their religion, called Moriscos, were required to wear a blue crescent, which brought violence from a fanatical population. And travel without a permit meant death. This suppression forced Muslims to seek refuge in mountain regions such as Ronda. The tower and front facade of the Church of Santa Maria de Mahor make it look like a city hall, with balconies which were added so that the nobility and gentry could watch tournaments, bullfights and other events from above. The interior of the church contains many artifacts. Evidence has suggested that the site has been a sanctuary since biblical times. Before the present church, another Catholic cathedral, demolished in an earthquake in 1518, had replaced a mosque, which had replaced an older Christian church from Visigoth times, which had been built on a still older Roman altar, possibly a temple to Diana, built to honor the victory of Julius Caesar over the forces of Pompey in the year 45 BC. In the square next to the church, we find a comfortable place to have a tapas lunch, washed down with chilled local white wine. As mentioned, the Muslims in Spain had a rough time. In 1566, Philip II decreed the use of the Arabic language illegal, and doors were to remain open on Fridays to show that no Muslim prayers were being conducted. This led to several open rebellions, one of them in Ronda, where after a ferocious battle, the king's army was defeated. So violent was the rebellion that no soldier's life was spared. This prompted the king to order a massacre of all Moriscos in Ronda. Survivors were sold into slavery. Ernest Hemingway, who spent many summers in Ronda, describes in his novel For Whom the Bell Tolls the execution of nationalists by being thrown from cliffs. This is presumably based on killings that took place in Ronda at the cliffs of El Tajo centuries before. The escarpment and gorge served as the most formidable defense of Ronda. The gorge El Tajo is quite narrow, only 68 meters at its widest, but in places very deep, up to 120 meters. The spectacular setting of the gorge and the bridge makes Ronda one of the most interesting Andalusian towns. On Tuesday we go on a bus tour to Granada to visit the Alhambra, a Moorish palace and fortress complex originally constructed in 889 on the remains of Roman fortifications. Rebuilt in the 11th century and converted into a royal palace in 1333 by the Sultan of Granada. After the Christian Reconquista in 1492, the site became the royal court of King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. However, the complex was partly destroyed by the conquerors, and after the reign of Philip V in the early 1700s, the site fell into disrepair, with only thieves and vagabonds occupying the site, using the rooms as dung heaps. The Alhambra was rediscovered following the defeat of Napoleon. It is now a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Various Catholic monarchs altered much of the Alhambra after the conquest, and in 1527 the palace of Charles V was started on the ruins of some Moorish structures, thereby destroying the greater part of the Sultan's winter palace. Charles V, also known as Charles I of Spain, wanted to construct a permanent residence befitting him as the Holy Roman Emperor. However, the building was never fully finished, and the king never lived here due to the Morisco rebellions in Granada. The circular courtyard of the palace is surrounded by two levels of colonnades, showing a deep knowledge of the architecture of the Roman era. Despite long neglect, willful vandalism, and some ill-judged restorations, the Alhambra endures as a typical example of Muslim art in its final European stages, relatively uninfluenced by the Byzantine influences as found in the Mesquita of Cordoba. The majority of the Alhambra buildings are of a quadrangular plan, with all the rooms opening onto a central court. Although the palace complex was extended by various Muslim rulers, each new section that was added followed a consistent theme of paradise on earth. Columned arcades, fountains with running water and reflecting pools were used to add to the aesthetic and functional complexity. In every case, the exterior was left plain and austere. Sun and wind were freely admitted. Blue, red, and golden yellow were the colors mostly used. Painted tiles were largely used as paneling for the walls. Decorations consist as a rule of Arabic inscriptions, which are manipulated into sacred geometrical patterns wrought onto arabesques. These decorations come from the last great period of Andalusian art in Moorish Granada. Much of the architectural ornamentation is carved in stucco rather than in stone. After the Reconquista, the marvelous decorations of open carved stucco were filled with whitewash, the painting and gilding smeared over, and much of the furnishings either destroyed or removed. Designed to reflect the very beauty of paradise itself, the Alhambra is made up of gardens, fountains and streams, a palace and a mosque, all within an imposing fortress wall. The Alhambra integrates natural site qualities with constructed structures and gardens, and is a testament to Moorish culture in Spain and the skills of Muslim, Jewish and Christian artisans, craftsmen and builders of the era. It is a place where artists and intellectuals took refuge as the Reconquista by Spanish Christians won victories over Andalusia. The Chamber of the Ambassador, also known as the Throne Room, was reserved for the Sultan. It was supposedly in that setting that Christopher Columbus received the support of Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand to sail to the New World. The walls of that hall are completely covered with decorations. Rich plasterwork combines geometric patterns in plasterwork or stucco, decorated with leaf and flower motifs. Originally, it was painted with bright colors that formed tapestry-like relief patterns. The ceiling, a splendid work of marquetry, shows a symbolic layout representing the seven heavens, using 8,000 cedar pieces in the shapes of circles, crowns and stars in white, blue and gold. The Palace of the Lions, built around 1375, is the architectural pinnacle of the Alhambra. In the center of the court is the Fountain of Lions, an alabaster basin supported by 12 lions of white marble, not designed with sculptural accuracy, but as symbols of strength, power, and sovereignty. Each hour, one lion would produce water from its mouth. The hydraulic water system is a simple example of the Muslim engineering skills at that time. The proportional and visual perfection of the surrounding arched gallery, supported by 124 irregularly placed columns, converts this court into one of the most celebrated architectural structures. The central open-air courtyard was flanked by a number of rooms, such as the hall of the Abbesserages. That room is a perfect square, featuring a lofty dome with trellised windows. The roof is decorated in blue, red, brown and gold. 16th century legend has it that a lovelorn member of the Abbesserages family was caught climbing up to the window of a lady of the royal family, which prompted the enraged Sultan to have the whole family slaughtered in this hall after inviting them to a lavish banquet. With its stalactite vaulting, it is one of the most beautiful courts of the Alhambra, as is the so-called Hall of the Twin Sisters next door. In that hall, the plasterwork decoration is divided into large stretches separated by inscriptions covering the walls, and culminating in a masterfully executed 8-point stalactite star of the cupola, which is said to be honeycombed with more than 5,000 tiny cells that are all different. This portico and reflecting pool of the Partel Palace date from the early 14th century. When Napoleon's troops retreated in 1812, they blew up most of the towers of the ramparts. Fortunately, enough survived the willful destruction to give us a glimpse of what it was like. From the citadel of the Alhambra, we have a clear view of New Granada. And now we will go into that city. At the moment, the fountain works, but later on, it too will have stopped for siesta. The Basilica de Notre Seigneur de las Angustias dates from 1617. The front is flanked by two tall towers, which incorporate small chapels. On its facade, we see this beautiful Pietà. The church is situated on this wide boulevard. Intricate mosaic pavement is typical for this region. Soon we move across Plaza del Carmen, past Granada's City Hall, with this bronze equestrian statue on its roof. We notice some grotesque sculptures featured on lampposts as we get closer to the old city center and the Alcazar silk market. In the nearby mountains, silkworms have forever feasted upon leaves of the mulberry tree, and the raw material used to be brought by mule to Granada, where the silk threads were woven and sold. The arched gateways of the bazaar were locked and guarded at night. The area used to be larger, but a fire in 1843 destroyed most of it, and the market was rebuilt on a smaller scale. Nowadays, mostly souvenirs are traded and bargains are hard to find. Shortly after the conquest of Granada, the Catholic monarch Queen Isabella ordered the construction of the 16th century cathedral in the center of the city over the Great Mosque. Various architects worked on the edifice, as is reflected in the different styles. The redesigned 17th century facade is a marvel of Baroque architecture. It has the shape of a triumphal arch as a sign of victory of the Christians over the Moors. The portal of the northern facade of Granada's cathedral is in the Plateresque style. Unfortunately, the church is closed to visitors this day. On Wednesday morning, we drive to the white town of Mijas. The warm winds coming off the mountains almost blow us off our feet as we amble through the picturesque streets. The enchanting white village of Mijas was founded already in prehistoric times. It nestles on a mountainside at 428 meters above sea level. According to legend, in June 1586, two young shepherds were guided by the Holy Virgin here to the rock face, where an image of her has supposedly lain hidden in a recess for 500 years. Inside the shrine is the statue of the Virgin of the Rock, patron saint of the village. The Romans, who kept up a lively commerce with Mijas, knew it as Tamisa. After a period of Visigoth rule, the Moors conquered the area. They allowed the inhabitants to preserve their properties, religion and customs, in exchange for some goods from farming and commerce. The Moors abbreviated the name Tamisa to Mijas, which later became Mijas. In 1487, Mijas resisted the attacks of the conquistadors during the siege of Malaga. When Malaga fell, Mijas surrendered, and most inhabitants were sold into slavery. A few decades later, during the Spanish uprising against the rule of Charles V in 1520, Mijas remained loyal to the Spanish crown and was rewarded the title of Very Loyal. Shortly thereafter, it was deemed exempt from royal taxes. Today, the economy of Mijas is mostly based on tourism. In the center of the village is the pretty white church of San Sebastian, restored in the late 17th century. Inside, the rather plain white walls contrast with the ornate altar and cupola above it. It is far too windy to sit outside for lunch, but inside it is warm and cozy. After leaving Mijas, we drive back to the coast to visit the old castle at Fuengirola. Constructed in the 10th century, the castle was destroyed and rebuilt several times during its long and turbulent history. During the Moorish occupation, the area around the castle seems to have been used as pasture for camels of the Moorish rulers, until the Christians took power and it once again became the fortress of the town called Suhai. In the early Middle Ages, the town was set on fire and its inhabitants fled to Mijas. The town became a mound of ruins and its name was changed to the spring found at the foot of the castle, Fuengirola. In 1485, when only the fortress remained, the settlement, along with the rest of the Kingdom of Granada, fell into the hands of the Christian monarchs. Restoration began in 1989, and now its courtyard has become a venue for open-air concerts and plays. There is little else left to see, and thus we end up on the beach for another glass of chilled white wine. On Thursday, we join another bus tour to visit the Mesquita of Cordoba. It is thought that the Romans originally built this bridge during the reign of Augustus, as part of the Via Augusta that went from Rome to Cadiz. It has a length of almost 250 meters and has 16 arches, none of which are original, as the bridge has been renovated several times. At the far end, the square gate, flanked by two sets of Doric columns, is Puerta del Puente, the entrance to the bridge. Designed in 1572 in the days of King Philip II, more than 300 years after the reconquest of Cordoba, and only 80 years after the fall of Granada to the east, it replaces an older Moorish gate. Nearby is a most ostentatious monument erected in honor of Saint Raphael. It was finished by a Frenchman in the 18th century in distinctive Rococo style. The Mosque Cathedral of Cordoba, called the Mesquita, is a medieval Islamic mosque that was converted into a Roman Catholic cathedral. Originally, the large orange tree courtyard of the mosque was a place for public activities. A room for ablutions prior to prayer was added, for which water was provided from a large water tank under the orange trees. The minaret was remodeled into a bell tower by the Catholics in the 17th century. Until the Islamic conquest of Andalusia in 712, a Christian church stood here upon the site of a Roman temple. And on this site, the Sultan decided to raise a great mosque, rivaling those of Jerusalem, Damascus, and Mecca. He honorably offered to buy the church and land from the conquered people and allowed them to rebuild other ruined churches. His attitude towards the Christian population was kind and conciliatory. The building of the mosque employed thousands of artisans and laborers, and the Sultan himself moved among the workers to direct them. The building is most notable for its arcaded hall with 856 columns of jasper, onyx, marble, and granite. These were made from pieces of destroyed Roman buildings, such as the Roman temple which had occupied the site previously. The double arches were a new introduction to architecture, permitting higher ceilings. The double arch consists of a lower horseshoe arch and an upper semicircular arch. The alternating red and white blocks in the arches were inspired by the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. At the entrance to the Muslim prayer niche, or mihrab, we observe many statues of Christian saints placed within and blending with the Moorish art and craftsmanship. In 1236, Cordoba was captured by King Ferdinand III in the Reconquista. Fortunately, the Catholics did not demolish the phenomenal structure. However, the center of the mosque was converted into a Catholic church. Kings who followed added further Christian features. But it was Emperor Charles V who in the early 16th century gave permission for the most significant alteration, the building of a cathedral nave in the middle of the large structure. Once he saw it, he sadly commented, "They have taken something unique in all the world and destroyed it to build something you can find in any city." Just the same, the interior of the Renaissance Cathedral is absolutely stunning. Construction of the cathedral within the Great Mosque started in 1523. It meant tearing down the center of the great edifice and blending new Renaissance architecture with the old Moorish one. The floor plan with a transept and apse has Gothic and Baroque vaults. The lofty Renaissance dome was added later. The high altar, made of red marble, was finished in the 17th century. Above the altar is a superb painting by famed artist Palomino. The up-to-date newer altar is richly decorated with gold leaf. The Baroque wood carving of the richly decorated choir stalls, added in the 18th century, is exquisite. Muslims across Spain have lobbied the Roman Catholic Church to allow them to pray in the complex, with the Islamic Council of Spain lodging a formal request with the Vatican. However, Spanish church authorities and the Vatican have opposed this move. In 2010, when several Austrian Muslims on an organized tour stopped to pray together, security guards stepped in and invited them to continue with their tour or leave the building. A fight broke out and two guards got seriously hurt. The cathedral has two massive pipe organs situated opposite each other in the choir. There are two magnificent 18th century pulpits in the cathedral, one on either side of the priest's choir. They are carved from mahogany, and at the bases are marble sculptures. Below the pulpit on the right, one of the sculptures features the angel of St. Matthew, who appears to be gesturing upward towards the speaker. Aside from the Christian cathedral, the Mesquita is one of Spain's most impressive monuments, one of a kind, and is considered one of the highest achievements of Moorish art in Spain. After we leave the Mesquita, we visit perhaps the most photographed alley in Spain. Through this flower-lined laneway, we have a great view of the bell tower of the cathedral, the former minaret of the Moorish mosque. Now we enter the old Jewish quarter, La Juderia. Cordoba's old Jewish quarter consists of a fascinating network of narrow lanes hiding some marvelous restaurants. Although the inevitable souvenir shops have sprung up everywhere, there still hangs an atmosphere of the olden days. Two small columns bearing Islamic decorations stand at the entrance to the 15th century funerary chapel of San Bartolome, one of Cordoba's most notable monuments, established after the expulsion of the Jews. Richly decorated, it is one of the finest examples of Mudéjar art, which is Spanish Catholic architecture influenced by Muslim art. The coat of arms belonged to the Knights of the Bent, a military order created by King Alfonso XI in 1330 and phased out by 1474. After the Temple of Solomon was destroyed in Jerusalem in the year 70, Cordoba became the largest Jewish community in Europe. As Jews were discriminated against and could not own land, they became doctors, interpreters, businessmen, and artisans. The only synagogue to partly survive these turbulent times is this structure built in 1315. We clearly see the upper section reserved for women. The walls of the synagogue had many decorations in the Mudéjar style, with flower motifs and geometric patterns. In a ruined niche, we see a menorah on display, while in an alcove we can still see a Christian cross painted on the wall. In 1492, the Catholic kings expelled the Jews from Spain, and the building passed to the Rabies Hospital, and later to the Shoemakers Guild. As expected, the Jewish quarter enshrines its greatest native, the philosopher and Torah scholar Maimonides, born here in 1135. He was a great writer, and his books were translated into Arabic, yet he was forced to move to Cairo in 1168, where he became the doctor to Sultan Saladin. Soon we are back at the Puerta del Perdón, entrance to the great courtyard with the minaret, now bell tower, opposite the main entrance to the Mesquita. It was built in the 14th century in Mudéjar style, that is Spanish Catholic architecture with Muslim influences. Now we walk along the outer walls of the enormous mosque complex. There are multiple portals and doorways that originally offered entrance to the large prayer hall. It is so sad to see the ravages of time and neglect. Of course, in this day and age, to maintain such a structure is virtually impossible. We can clearly see how acid rain has ruined the sculptures, and how nature is slowly taking over and deteriorating the stonework. Eventually, we get back to where we started. The Roman Bridge. The enormous water wheel is a reconstruction of an original built by the Romans and improved upon by the Sultans to take water up to the palace gardens. Queen Isabella ordered it destroyed, as she couldn't stand its squeaking noise. On Friday, our last day, we drive into Malaga. Malaga's oldest church, the Church of Santiago, founded in 1490, was built on the site of a former mosque. It was remodeled in the 17th century for a Baroque look. The church was damaged during the Spanish Civil War and restored in 1944. It is interesting to note that Pablo Picasso was baptized in this church in 1881. We now move to the cathedral, the tower of which is 84 meters, 276 feet high, making this the second highest cathedral in Andalusia. It has only one tower, as the second one was never completed. Hence the building is called La Mesquita, meaning the one-armed lady. The facade, unlike the rest of the building, is in the Baroque style. Because construction took 250 years, the cathedral has three different architectural styles. The interior is Gothic. Once inside, we are overwhelmed by its grandeur. The ceiling or roof is very unusual because it has 23 cupolas, the only church in Spain with this feature. Hidden behind the choir is a marble sculpture of the Pietà, done by the Pisano brothers in Italy in 1803. There are many chapels to admire in the cathedral, such as this one, the Chapel of the Sacred Heart. The figure of Christ is surrounded by beautiful paintings, all framed in dazzling gold. To the right is a scene of the crucifixion, with the Virgin at the bottom of the cross. This 17th century painting of the Immaculate Conception is nicely framed by sets of Baroque pillars. However, this painting of the Immaculate Conception is most famous. Placed between long pillars with elegant Corinthian capitals, the two 18th century Baroque organs still produce exquisite sound coming from over 4,000 pipes. Here is the Chapel of St. Francis. This painting depicts the gruesome beheading of St. John the Baptist, ordered by Herod Antipas. The Chapel of the Incarnation, namesake of the cathedral, shows a neoclassical altarpiece designed in 1785 with white alabaster sculptures. One of the most beautiful chapels is the Chapel of Santa Barbara. It shows the crucifixion and many statues of saints, fathers of the church, and the four evangelists. The Flemish Gothic decorative panels were done in 1524. The notable choir stalls of mahogany and cedar wood were designed in the 17th century by Louis Ortiz. After his death, the 42 finely carved statues of saints behind each stall were made by Pedro de Mena, one of Spain's most celebrated woodcarvers of the era. The church has a fabulous domed ceiling of 23 separate cupolas. The keystone of each cupola has its own special design. Before saying farewell to Andalusia, we visit the Alcazaba, a well-preserved Moorish fortress palace. Adjacent to the entrance to the Alcazaba are ruins of the Roman theater, dating from the 1st century before Christ. Some of its columns were used in the construction of the fortress. Built in the early 11th century, the Alcazaba was already 3 centuries old when the Alhambra in Granada was built. The entrance into the Moorish Alcazaba is protected by a number of zigzagging curtain walls and gates, designed so that attackers would have difficulty getting any momentum with either horsemen or battering rams. After getting through one arch, they would have to make a sharp turn to try and reach the next one. The walkways doubled as drainage ditches. As in any good Arab garden, water was very important. The channel started near the top of the hill, where a 40-foot deep well ensured that the castle would never surrender due to thirst. But blood flowed here after the Christians conquered the place. Ferdinand and Isabella captured Malaga from the Moors in 1487, after one of the longest sieges in the Reconquista. Much of the town was enslaved, including 50 girls sent to the Queen of Naples. One-time Christians, who had long before converted to Islam and were called renegados, were tied to stakes and used for target practice. Jews were ransomed. Fortress Granada, 100 kilometers from Malaga, watched and learned and negotiated a much more favorable settlement to its siege 4 years later, including a favorable exit strategy for the Sultan. Fortunately for us, much of the Alcazaba survived the willful destruction brought about by the Christian conquerors. It provides us with the opportunity to admire the art, craftsmanship and ingenuity of the Muslim world of centuries ago. And now it is time for us to find the airport for our flight home.